And done. Two videos in 1 week. You're killing it. You know, it's a shame I didn't see that much about Silksong. So in the process of uploading yesterday's video, I refreshed the page and the first thing I see in my recommended section is a 19-minute long Nintendo video detailing Silksong's gameplay. So, yeah. Sorry, I kinda missed that. So to follow suit, here's an even longer video analyzing some of the new gameplay elements that were revealed to us in various demo clips and the Nintendo Treehouse footage, as well as some more in-depth details and features that you likely missed while getting swept up by all the hype. Silksong is the acclaimed sequel to Team Cherry's Hollow Knight, released in February of 2017. Hollow Knight borrows inspiration from traditional 2D animation and blending Metroidvania-esque elements into their combat, exploration, and story. Silksong takes what was so alluring about Hollow Knight's controls, design, and overall universe, and doubles down further on what has worked in the past, while definitely introducing new features all on its own, such as using shell shards to repair certain tools. The UI and core game mechanics remain somewhat the same, creating this really nice familiarity to the avid players of the original Hollow Knight. Benches still serve as checkpoints for Hornet, just as they did for the Knight. Tools replace charms, Silk replaces soul, rosaries replace Geo, and although we didn't get much of a peek of it, a commentator from the Nintendo Treehouse video currently being cited did mention a map system that you will have to explore to fill out, once again mirroring the exploration mechanics of the original Hollow Knight. Silksong is the prime example, paragon, and poster child of the phrase, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. That being said, I'm really looking forward. Stop. Stop everything. Stop. I want that hoodie. I want the. Is it on sale anywhere? I don't give a shit. I want that hoodie. Make it a thing. Silksong has been frequently referred to as the Bloodborne to Hollow Knight's Dark Souls, and whether or not you find yourself cringing at that comparison, it's hard to deny that Silksong definitely operates at a faster pace. Hornet's animations when moving seem a lot more acrobatic, and just looking at the fluidity of Hornet's motions, it already looks like a really fun game to just sit down and pass some time with. Even the act of healing, or binding as this game calls it, seems to work much faster when compared to the healing mechanic in the original Hollow Knight, but that's certainly not to say Silksong is without challenge. Despite the process of healing looking much easier, there are still some drawbacks to healing at the wrong time, and since topping yourself off is much easier and faster, the drawbacks of healing at the wrong moment are actually quite severe. During the battle with a mysterious rival known as Lace, the featured boss fight in Nintendo's Treehouse segment, it's hard to really break down what happens here since this is such a chaotic fight sequence, but there is a certain point around here where the player catches some damage while attempting to heal, and it seems like if you happen to get hit and take damage from something, not only does the healing not go through, but your Silk reservoir also diminishes completely, leaving the player looking pretty helpless. So despite healing definitely being a faster process that's easier to get the hang of, the risks of healing at the wrong time seem just as significant. Just because Hornet is much more agile and seasoned in combat than the Knight doesn't mean you'll just be able to wildly jump around and swing your nail at anything while completely disregarding timing. Paying attention to when you're healing and when you're attacking seems to be even more critical than before. I wonder if the same works for certain items and tools, where if you happen to take damage during the tool's wind-up time, the tool you currently have equipped would maybe shatter or get damaged or something to the point where you'd need to repair it. Maybe the lifeblood syringe, for example, the item we saw in the very first Silksong gameplay trailer around 3-ish months ago. If you remember going over what we did, we saw this item healing 2 masks of health. The idea that this item could potentially break when using it at the wrong time definitely adds an extra layer of depth and interest to Silksong's combat. The silk system in Silksong is the replacement of soul in Hollow Knight, and although we were only somewhat able to see what that system entailed in the original trailer, we do get a much better look at this system in action here, and we can tell a little more about what exactly is going on with this silk meter at the top left corner of the UI. So there seems to be 8 notches of silk that you can carry at once, and I'm assuming, much like in Hollow Knight, this is going to be upgradable as well. Hitting standard enemies seem to replenish just 1 notch each, and when the gauge is full, an indicator directly to the left of your health suddenly entangles itself in silk like a sort of spool mechanism. I was thinking this was a separate indicator entirely, sort of like the extra 3 bubbles at the left side of your soul meter when you collected soul vessels in Hollow Knight, but it rather seems to be a quick indication that you are at your capacity. This could be a way of telling the player that healing or binding is now accessible, since this is placed so close to the health bar, and I think there might be a little bit of truth to that, because in literally all of the gameplay I've seen so far, I've only ever caught players healing themselves with a full silk capacity, and if that's the case, then this is a much more interesting system than I initially gave it credit for. This is a really engaging system that would force the player to stay somewhat combative, despite being critically low on health. There's also a glimpse of Hornet swiping at a certain enemy and instantly refilling her silk gauge completely. There didn't seem to be anything special about this particular enemy. She didn't gain any rosaries, so this couldn't have been an enemy she was killed by previously. Perhaps there's another tool of some sort that's being used, possibly one that would occupy a blue or yellow slot that makes it much easier to swipe silk off of certain enemies. So the TLDR of it is basically healing is kind of risky business. That seems to be the consequence of being as acrobatic as Hornet. You can tell just by looking at raw gameplay that Hornet's moveset and controls were designed with the intention of the player moving through areas quickly. There's a ledge grab animation, for instance, that plays whenever Hornet jumps to a higher platform, in addition to an aerial somersault, and what seems to be Hornet dashing forward here and carrying that into a sprint action instead of resuming her normal walking pace. We can see this demonstrated more clearly here as Hornet sprints across what might be lava or hot coals so as to not get damaged by the heat, but where Hornet is able to take advantage of a much more acrobatic moveset, a lot of her enemies seem to follow suit. In the showcased Deep Docks level, a majority of the enemies have protective headgear and therefore cannot be attacked using downward strikes or lunges of any kind. These enemies can only be attacked frontally, which is where they just so happen to be the most dangerous, as most of these enemies can be seen walking around with spears or pokers that give their frontal attacks a pretty good range. It's actually a really smart enemy design that forces you into a different playstyle that you might not be used to. Again, hopping back to the featured battle with Lace, she definitely has a more convoluted moveset than just about anything I can think of in the original Hollow Knight. She chains together certain attacks in ways that need to be played around defensively, despite Hornet having such a fast and acrobatic moveset. So, even though you can take advantage of speed unlike the Knight, there are certain enemies and adversaries you'll face that will definitely be faster than you. Granted, the wide arsenal of tools and offensive items at Hornet's disposal definitely helps with some of the chaos, and we see quite a bit of gameplay, for example, of Hornet using a throwing knife, which was actually an item we did see demonstrated in the first official gameplay trailer. Additionally, a quantity gauge has been added, which was something I was always curious about, because when I looked at the original gameplay trailer, there didn't seem to be anything on the UI that was indicative of usable items or how many you could use for that matter, but these tools are not impeccable. They're of very limited use and are certainly susceptible to breakage. That's where a new item, the Shell Shard, comes in. The Shell Shard is an item in Hornet's inventory that can be used to repair certain items and tools. At a glance, it appears that the player is only limited to 400 of them at a time, but who's to say this capacity couldn't be subject to upgrading in the future? One thing I found interesting about the way Shell Shards work is that while staying true to the trope of dying and losing all your currency, your collection of Shell Shards remain untouched, and I'm actually really glad they thought ahead like this, because I can imagine imagine how helpless of a place Hornet would be in if she were killed and sent back to a bench with no way to refill or repair any of her tools. I'm not sure how many throwing knives you can carry with you at once, but judging by the UI at the top left, it looks to be about 5 or 6, and around 40 shell shards to restore the knives to their max capacity. I'm also not sure if this is a manual input, because it doesn't seem like a button or anything is being pressed here. It's sort of like when the knight rests at a bench and then starts jotting stuff down on the map. The expending of these shell shards seem to just kind of happen automatically whenever you rest at a bench. But while we're on the subject of how tools work, I want to revisit a statement that was made by one of the commentators on Nintendo's Silksong gameplay video. While playing, it was said that although Hornet's tools will sort of act as a replacement to the charm system, there will be just as vast of a selection. Now, I imagine these are specific tools that you won't be able to just adjust on the fly. If it's really designed to mirror the charm system, then you'll likely need to be resting at a bench to make such adjustments to your loadout. This can lead to experimenting with certain items in combat and how they work against certain enemies, which can help you better strategize and plan ahead for a really difficult fight, sort of like what you did with certain charm builds in the original Hollow Knight. But this throwing knife wasn't only demonstrated here in the very first gameplay trailer, it was also seen as a selectable item here on the tools menu, and this is where things get a little interesting, because despite not seeing this menu anywhere in the most recent 19 minutes of footage, we do have a little more insight as to what exactly this menu is telling us. The tools seem to be compartmentalized into three different groups, color-coded red, blue, and yellow. The items in the red slot seem to be either items that are specifically combat-oriented, or maybe a type of consumable, given that the lifeblood syringe mentioned earlier is also in this category. And this could mean the blue and yellow slots might be reserved for other passive effects and buffs to Hornet's core abilities, somewhat akin to the effects of a charm like Long Nail or Sprint Master in the original Hollow Knight. The land of Farloom seems to be a land of new and strange discoveries, but we actually see some familiar faces that we saw in the gameplay trailer. The playable demo is ended after the Moss Mother fight, where Hornet seems to hunch over as though being weakened by something or some magical force. And the scene does cut off soon after, but we're led to believe this shrouded figure has something to do with it. Well, this actually isn't the first time we've seen this character though, right? If we take a glance back at the first gameplay trailer, we did see a full non-silhouette shot of this character. Additionally, the trailer brings this character up to be an ally, but here we see Hornet very obviously struggling against something that is pretty clearly insinuated to be caused by this figure. Well, this is the end of the playable demo, so maybe the animation of Hornet hunching over was something that was thrown in to just signify that. Another character we've been introduced to before is the Smith, known as the Forge Daughter in the Deep Docks. We've been given a bit of an extension on how dialogue will go with the Smith, and this may change between now and the final release, but it seems as though she isn't too keen on initially helping Hornet, or offering any of her services before a later part in the game, possibly when a bigger quest or favor has been fulfilled. But this was someone we did see in the original trailer, and it's pretty cool that we actually not only get to put a name to the face, but we are given a peek into a new dialogue sequence between Hornet and the Forge Daughter. Something else that might be significant is the Forge Daughter also refers to herself with the royal pronouns we or us, speaking as though she has nobility in her lineage. And speaking of dialogue, yes, Hornet actually does talk, and this actually makes me incredibly happy that Hornet doesn't fall into this silent protagonist trope, whereas that sort of character befits the knight very well, and there are certainly more ways to tell a grand story that doesn't involve direct dialogue. Hornet was always painted up to be a very lively, confident, and assertive character in Hollow Knight, and had the silent protagonist trope carried over to Silksong, I seriously doubt we would have seen that same Hornet incarnate that was brought up to be such a commanding and vocal figure in the first game. This also means the opportunity to write in some extremely sassy clapbacks thrown in towards some of Hornet's rivals, and if I had to guess, they probably didn't skip out on the opportunity to put in some pretty nice zingers into Hornet's dialogue every now and then. I think the short dialogue sequence with Lace, if anything else, is a testament to Hornet's character. She doesn't really seem to be in the mood for monologues, however, she certainly seems to be in the mood to tell you that. Having said that before, Hornet was built up to be a very vocally assertive character in the first game, and now more than ever, I'm convinced they were doing that for this reason. Hornet seems to be a really sharp individual, and I really hope that's reflected in some of the other interactions that we're going to see. Something else that one of the commentators on Nintendo's Silksong video kind of mentioned was Silksong seems to be very heavily music inspired. A large part of the level design incorporates bells and chimes and other musical devices. You can activate certain benches and rest areas by ringing a trio of bells. There's a heavy mention of bell tolling in certain prompts, and the word song in the title all suggests something to do with a underlying musical theme. In fact, one of the commentators on Nintendo's Treehouse video did make this comment that one of the enemies in the Deep Dock section seems to be using a sort of cast bronze cymbal or some sort of instrument-looking piece of equipment as a shield, which, given the context of the commentary, this was obviously a joke, but I don't know. Given how commonplace such items seem to be in the level design, I don't know, I think she was onto something when she said that. No doubt some extra creative input from Hollow Knight's music composer Christopher Larkin. We've already been given a taste of some of the in-game soundtrack, and I don't know about anyone else, but I sure am larking what I'm hearing. I'm sorry, I can't finish that joke. I can't do that to you, I'm sorry. But bells and chimes and things that ring don't seem to be the only objects you can interact with. During certain parts of the combat, some of Hornet's attacks will strike miscellaneous objects in the foreground, like signs and smaller architecture. And though it's just a really small addition, this tweak, I think, makes the world of Farloom seem much more animated. Whereas Hollow Nest had a very limited scope of NPCs and interactions just because of how desolate and dried up the kingdom was, Farloom seems much more alive. And that's told not only through the interactions with new NPCs and the game's many musical elements, but also represented through the level design itself. Things seem to swing and move with a sort of life that you didn't really see in Hollow Nest. And even when you aren't attacking, you can still see signs and objects suspended from platforms that are slightly dangling and swinging and behaving as though they're being moved by a breeze. Everything from the particle effects to the silk reservoirs all behave in a way that just seems a lot more alive and animated. Rosary strings are an item that you pick up in Silksong, and considering the currency of Farloom is indeed rosaries, this seems to be another high currency item pickup that you can probably exchange somewhere, as though you're picking up a Hollow Nest seal or King's Idol in Hollow Knight. You would think that since it's just a string made entirely of rosaries, it wouldn't be necessary to exchange it, but these items are picked up in the demo and your rosary count doesn't seem to pop up anywhere or do something to indicate it going up. So this is probably an item that you would need to give to a vendor type NPC in exchange for currency or other resources. But what this does have me thinking about is the variety of currency-based items you could also discover. We don't really know the exact value of a rosary string, and we aren't given anything to go on regarding its level of rarity in comparison to other currency-based items you'll find laying around. But I would argue that the value of a rosary string is probably on the lower side, considering the Moss Grotto is the game's introductory biome where you're just getting the hang of Hornet's controls, and you find a rosary string in a pretty accessible location in this area, which makes me think these strings are actually pretty common. The Wanderer's Journals of Silksong, if you will. Perhaps these could be traded in for other resources as well, like shell shards later on. Only time will tell at this point, but thankfully that time seems to be getting shorter and shorter. I know that lots of you routinely leave comments regarding things that I may have missed, but seriously, if there was anything you think deserved a bigger mention than what I gave it, or something that I may have been confused on, then please, you are completely welcome to hop down in the comments section and just spill out some details for the rest of us. I'll try and do what I can to bump these comments toward the top so everyone can see them. I'm Rusty, thanks for tuning into The Forge, and I'll see you next time. Take it easy.